morning.
Is that the morning?
Lord be with you. Good morning. We're glad that you're all here. We really are glad that you're all here, believe me. The session decided that every month on the fourth Sunday of the month, we'd worship it here. Now, we had already planned to play today in the other room, and the musicians, you know, Kathy and Susan, they're all, you know, at the beach or somewhere. And so we said, well, we'll just do it in the chapel and hope that nobody gets mad. So we'll see how this goes. But you should know the opening hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing, and we're going to sing it, you know, straight out of the hymnal, except that we're going to play kind of a reggae kind of rhythm. So we're going to sing a little different. And the rest of it's pretty much as written. So we hope that you enjoy this. So again, welcome, and it's good to see you all here.
I will call to mind the deeds of the Lord.
I will remember your wonders of old.
I will meditate on all your work and muse on your mighty deeds.
Your way, O God, is holy. What God is so great as our God?
You are the God who works wonders. You have displayed your might among the peoples.
Let us worship God and let us pray. We will boast of your presence among us, O God, and magnify your holy name. You still the avenger. You bring low the mighty. You exalt the humble and forget not your own. We are privileged to be numbered among those you have chosen, and through Christ seek to honor you in all that we do. Hear our praises, which we raise before you, as in glad adoration our tributes we bring. Our sins are be to God. Amen.
Well done. can sit up here with the kids too. You scooch on over. Scooch on over. There we go. All right. Well, I've got a very fun, colorful shirt on today. These are our Cedar Creek shirts. This is what our team made. And our team was up in the mountains in Tennessee on a mission trip this week. And these kids worked really hard. Like, you know, a lot of them, Miss Sarah and Peyton and Mason and a bunch of them. Yeah. And so they went and did God's work. Now, we talked last week about Elijah and how he listened for God's still small voice to tell him what to do. And sometimes God's still small voice calls you to go on mission trips. Now, you don't have to go far away like we did to Cedar Creek, or sometimes we go to Guatemala, which is even further away. Sometimes we can do mission work right here where we live in Newton. So today for blast, Miss Sarah is going to talk to you about her trip that she went on with us on a mission trip, and she's going to tell you what we did and all the projects we worked on and things like that. And you can ask her questions, because one day, I hope when you get bigger, you can go on mission trips with me too. Because they're fun. And that's one way that we can answer God's call to help other people. Okay? And another thing you're going to talk about is we're going to think real hard about maybe what you can do to help people in our community, right? Because even though you may be little, little hands can do big work. All right? So, if you're heading to blast, we're going to meet Miss Suzanne. She's going to come up front. You're going to go right through that door, okay? And but before we do that, let's say our prayer, okay? You ready? All right. Repeat after me. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For trusting us.
For trusting us.
To go out.
To go out.
And do your work.
And do your work.
Amen.
Gracious God, we do live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from your mouth. Make us hungry for this heavenly food, that it may nourish us today in the ways of eternal life, through Jesus Christ, the bread of heaven. Amen.
And we read from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 15. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Elisha, stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The company of prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said, "Do you know that today the Lord will take your master away from you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know. Be silent." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives, and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. 50 men of the company of prophets also went and stood at some distance from them, as they both were standing by the Jordan. Then Elijah took his mantle and rolled it up and struck the water. The water was parted to the one side and to the other, until the two of them crossed on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, Tell me what I may do for you before I am taken from you. Elisha said, please let me inherit a double share of your spirit. And he responded, you have asked a hard thing. Yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it will be granted to you. If not, it will not. And as they continued walking and talking, a chariot of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah ascended in a whirlwind into heaven. Elisha kept watching and crying out, Father, Father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen. And when he could see him no longer, he grasped his own clothes and tore them in two pieces. He picked up the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and went back and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? And when he had struck the water was parted to the one side and to the other. And Elisha went over. And when the company of prophets who were at Jericho saw him at a distance, they declared, the spirit of Elijah rests on Elisha. They came to meet him and bowed to the ground before him. Word of the Lord. So Elisha is a disciple and co-worker of Elijah. Wish we could like rename them Tom and Sam or something so we can keep them straight. Well, he follows Elijah. Not stopping, not letting him go, until Elijah is taken up in the chariots of fire into heaven. He sees him go, makes his plea, his wish is granted. He will receive a double portion of Elijah's spirit. And he'll be a prophet of the highest rank. But all the way along, everybody tells him to stop and wait. Elijah's leaving. You should stay here. You know, spare yourself the pain. Now, these schools of prophets, they're groups in different places. And they've learned from Elijah and others what prophets do, how to act. And they're all full of advice for Elisha. But Elisha will not be deterred from staying with Elijah. His mentor is leaving, and Elisha means to see him off. So they cross the Jordan River, and the chariots of fire take Elijah up into heaven. When Elisha returns from across the Jordan in the confidence of what he's called to do, he's a successor to Elijah. And so the transition of power goes smoothly between Elijah and Elisha. Now, Elisha had a call. Elijah called him in 1 Kings 19. Elijah recognized in him the qualities that the office of prophet required. He threw his mantle over Elisha and recruited him then as a disciple. Now, other prophets are called in a more direct fashion. You might remember Isaiah 6, where he's in the temple and all of a sudden he has a vision of God and starts to freak out. God calls many of the prophets then directly, but in this case, Elijah is called by Elijah. Well, we all have a call. Did you know that? You thought about that? We all have this general call to follow Jesus. And it came on us officially at our baptism. You were baptized, you have a call. You're called to follow faithfully, to be and do what Jesus called you to do and be. You're called to follow his way, follow his lead, to live the life that he lived back then. And all who believe are called to this life. Now, some people have a more particular call.
ministry in a particular service. You know, in my case, it's to the pulpit in the local congregation. Not everybody gets that kind of call, but some do. So we have the general call for everybody, everybody who's baptized, and then we have a special call that where God calls certain people into the ministry. And there are various ways to respond to these callings. Over the years, I've known people who get serious about their faith, and immediately they start talking about going to seminary. Some of them should, and indeed did. And others just had no idea that a person could respond faithfully to God except in the ministry. So some of them shouldn't have gone to seminary, but did. Some of them shouldn't have and didn't. So there's all kinds of reactions. In my own case, I went to seminary mostly because I wanted to continue my studies in theology. God steered me to Princeton, thank God, because it's a denominational seminary and it took the ministry in the parishes very seriously. And they showed me exactly what it took to be a local parish minister, and I was having none of it. But then my daughter was born several months before graduation. We needed a job, you know, I needed an income. So I went to this local parish, and I worked with a man who was beloved, but who was very hard on me because my ideas about ministry were very different from his, and his were the only correct way. Somehow, through all of that, I stayed the course, and I even told God, I'll do this, but you got to make me like it. And God did. Well, enough about me. Let's talk about you, your call. What is your call? So maybe you're working that out as a volunteer in some way. Maybe you have a good idea of what it is that God wants from you. Maybe you have no idea what God is doing in your life. Or you can't see the connection between your work and your call. Well, John Calvin said, whatever it is that you do in life, farming or shopkeeping or whatever, that's your call. And you're called to do it well and serve the people. So I would say, if you're doing that well, you're doing it. You're following your call. You're serving God where He wants you to be. But if you've always had this, you know, itch to give up farming or shopkeeping and do something else, that could be the Spirit of God urging you, bumping you, nudging you to change careers. I knew a man in Farmington, Maine. Farmington, Maine was the headquarters of Mission at the Eastward, or as we called it, MAINT. And it's a cooperative ministry among several small rural churches. It provides housing assistance and food and heat and things like that to people in rural Maine where there's no work and there's not much to survive on. Well, the Camp Hill's congregation had been going up there doing home repairs for about 30-some years. And Scott was the director of MAINT, pastor of the local church, and one summer he said, you know, this Sunday I'm going to tell him I'm leaving. I said, Scott, you've been here 35 years. How could you leave him? He said, well, I want to retire here. But I can't just retire and go live next door and down the road. I've got to go somewhere else for a while so they get over me, realize they can survive without me, and then I'll come back and quietly move into my house. And he told me he'd been hired as a director of the Maine Seacoast Mission, which works with people on the coast of Maine who live on the islands. It's a very different job. But he said, I can work there 5 or 6 years, then I can come back to Farmington in retirement. So God was calling him to a new thing.
still ministry, but completely different kind of ministry. So Elisha comes back and takes over Elijah's work as a prophet in Israel. He's got the mantle of Elijah, which means that he continues Elijah's work and has Elijah's blessing. He's not called to do everything new and start over from scratch. You know, one of my pet peeves about our Presbyterian way of doing things is we've got this notion that the new pastor gets to start over and do everything a different way. You know, we'll wait for the new pastor to come. He can decide what's a good order of worship. He can decide about the committees. He can fire the guy that needs to be fired. And the proliferation of interim pastors in our denomination means that the presumption is, well, the pastor left, something must be wrong, and so we've got the prescription right here. I'll leave all that aside, but I have some strong opinions. Let's put it here. Elisha wears the mantle of Elijah. So he has Elijah's endorsement. He can carry on in the same spirit as Elijah did. And that means that they're both working with and responding to the Spirit of God as they go along. Elijah had the Spirit, and Elisha asked that he be given it as well. And later prophets didn't see it that way. They talked more about the word of God and the message. But Elijah thought of himself as having the same Spirit of God that Elijah had, that led him to do things that were symbolic and sometimes outrageous, but which always pointed back to God. Perhaps the most striking thing about this story is that Elijah is just taken up to heaven. You know, chariots of fire take him away. He flies up. He doesn't lay down and die. He doesn't get killed. He's carried into heaven without having to die. And he and Enoch in Genesis are the only two people in the Bible who go to heaven without dying. It isn't that Elijah goes this way as a reward. We saw last week, he's very human. Well, we don't know the reason. We really aren't told. This is how God chose to do it. You know, a friend of mine in seminary said, you know, the Presbyterian, like the Lord God, can do pretty much whatever it wants. That became our rule for answering polity questions, and it's a good rule. Here, the Lord God can do pretty much whatever he wants and does. And so for reasons that are not entirely clear, at least to me, Elijah is taken up. It's very impressive. Well, you may have read Tolkien's Lord of the Rings trilogy, and if you haven't read it, you really should. So the other night, you're watching the movies, and the movies are a good bit darker than the books, and they focus mostly on fight scenes, because fight scenes you can do with a computer, and all the other stuff that Tolkien wrote about is much more difficult. So at the end of the third movie, there's a scene where our hero Frodo awakens at Rivendell. And he's been through all these terrifying adventures, and he thought he was dead, but he's rescued, and he's apparently brought back to Rivendell, the home of the elves. And he awakens. And sitting on the end of the bed is Gandalf the Wizard, who has been instrumental in everything that happened, but as far as Frodo knew, he was dead. And he starts laughing, Frodo does. He's like, Gandalf, you're here. And he's smiling and laughing, and Gandalf starts laughing. It's a great celebration, and all of his friends pile into the room and start jumping on the bed, you know. It struck me that that might be what it's like to die. You wake up in this beautiful place, and there's Jesus. And he smiles at you, and you start laughing. And then all your friends come running in to greet you. analogy being taken up in bodily form, but it's close. It's good. Think about that. Well, in the New Testament, whenever they want to talk about Israel's history with God, they always refer to Moses and Elijah. The Transfiguration, these are the two who appear with Jesus. And Moses stands for the law. He got the law. And Elijah represents all the prophets that came after him. So Elijah was highly regarded. The scriptures say, yeah, he was taken up to God in chariots of fire. Well, God works in inscrutable, mysterious ways. And God does the unexpected and even the unheard of just because he can. God throws us off guard and keeps us guessing. We'll never know what God will do. But we can know this. As mysterious as the Father is, he will never leave us. He will never abandon us. He will never forsake us. We see his love in Jesus Christ that goes to the cross for us. We see the Spirit who is with us tirelessly, no matter how far off the path into the woods we wander. So let us take confidence in our call, whatever it is, however it works out in our lives, and let us do that work with unswerving dedication to God who calls us. Listen for the voice of the Spirit who tells us what we can do next. Whatever we do, let's hear the call of the grace of Jesus Christ, who loves us all. Thanks be to God. McDonald, Gary's sister, Beth, died last Sunday. We keep them in our prayers. Peggy Templeton is in the hospital.
She's been there for several days with
some sort of TIA stroke things going on. They're just not sure yet what it is. So Jim asked us to pray for her. And I know that many of you are, some of you are happy with the Supreme Court's decisions, and some of you are angry at the Supreme Court's decisions, and you may be happy at one and angry at the other. It's a time of turmoil in our country. And I don't have the time and haven't worked out all that I want to say about that because it's nuanced, and it's much more nuanced than what the Supreme Court said. But at any rate, we should love one another. Because whether we are this side or that side on this or that issue, we're all still the people Jesus has called together to be the church. And so let us love one another no matter what, even if we disagree. And let us pray. We ask for your Spirit on us, O God. It's difficult to be your church at a time when we differ on things. It's difficult to be your church at a time when we're different from all the other churches around us. It's difficult to know the way forward. It's also difficult to see blanket proclamations made instead of careful, nuanced positions taken. And so we ask you to send us your Spirit and be with us, forgive us for the things we've said and done that we shouldn't have, and make us to be your people. We pray for those on the court and in the government who we elected, and we pray for those who rule over us, and we pray that you will give them the extra gift of wisdom in the days to come. We pray for those who serve us overseas in difficult places. We pray that you will bring them home safely because peace will break out. And we do pray for peace. Peace in the Ukraine and peace everywhere. Because we follow the Prince of Peace and we know his rule. Some among us are sick, O God, and we pray for them. Some among us are in grief. We pray for them that they will be comforted. We pray for each other and that your healing Spirit will come upon us and touch us and be with us in all that we say and do. We make our prayers in the confidence of the name of Jesus and in the strong name of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Go in peace. Go and know.